Just want to tell you, it's been a long time since I've been back in Princeton, but you people, you've changed a little bit. You've aged. Okay, Jimmy, good boy. I brought my son, so he handled this. The first thing we want to do is get you singing. And you can sing along with us, and we're going to have just time for fun and fellowship tonight. And I just want you to know it's a real pleasure to be back here and to see so many wonderful friends and so many people who helped with this group to make this group what it is. And this is not the whole group. I just want you to know that. How many of you have never heard a sounds performance? Oh my goodness. You're not going to hear one tonight either, but. Okay. Well, you're going to hear from a good representation of this group. We were just amazed to be able to work with young people here in this church. Started with a 12-person youth choir, which was very typical for a Baptist church. And we had a great time. And I remember we did a matter of dinner at that first Christmas we were here. And it was a lot of fun. The church was very welcoming and friendly, and we were glad to be here. But the group, I don't know, it was just at the beginning, like David said, this was a time when God just was on the move.
Amen.
And he moved through Princeton, big time.
Amen.
And he brought us some of the most wonderful young people. At first I didn't think they were wonderful. They were full of energy, they were full of fun and full of angst maybe, but they weren't really what they are today. But I just want you to know that God transformed these young people, and I still think of them as kids. They aren't kids, but neither am I. And anyway, we just saw God do a work in these young people. And it was a time when guitars were starting to be in a church. And I remember the first time we did anything with a guitar, we went out to Glenwood Park because we were afraid to bring that into the church. But anyway, it was just wonderful to see how the church opened its arms to us and we're welcoming. We worked with the sounds over a 12-year span. And during that time, there were hundreds of kids. One time we had 24 different churches representing in the sounds, 24 different churches. And there were, one year we had 265 youth in the choir. We had to divide them into two choirs because what are you going to do? You can't even get 265 kids on one stage most of the time. And another thing that was really great about that time was we were able to go into the public schools. This was before God got kicked out, and we were able to go in. And I tell you, the Lord opened the doors to us to be able to share with so many young people. And of course, that they heard us, and they were interested, and they were having just fun singing. And so they came, and we just kept getting more and more and more. I just want to thank you, first of all, to First Baptist Church, because you were the church that enabled us to get started. We had no idea when we started with 12 kids of what was going to happen here. But I can tell you, God did what happened here. We didn't do it. We really didn't do it. But the Lord did, and we're so glad that he did. Tonight, I'm going to have you sing a little bit, but I'm also going to have them sing a little bit for you, and it's quite a little varied program. And I'm just so delighted to see some of these people I haven't seen for 45 years. That's a long time, people. Longer than some of you have lived. Okay. Anyway, okay, what was I going to say? Let's just get started. We're going to sing first. Okay. And Jane Carter Phillips, who has the same last name as me. Oh, by the way, my husband is not just loafing up here and not leading the group. He died in 2002, and you all knew him. A lot of you knew him. And I've told them earlier today, I feel a little bit like an imposter because I was not the leader during that time. I was the helper, and it was a lot of fun, but now I get to turn around and tell them what to do tonight, so I'm looking forward to that. Okay, and Jane's going to play soon and very soon, and you all probably know this, so send it. So sing it out. Okay. Tonight, lead the way, because this is really what this is really what Sounds was all about. We wanted God to lead the way.
Just like
To discover somehow or another the first youth musical that I know of that was really popular, and that was Tell It Like It Is by Ralph Carmichael and Kurt Kaiser. They were two incredible writers in this time. Well, anyway, we got hold of one of those pieces of music, and this group, along with a lot of others that probably some of them have actually gone on to see the Lord, just really got down behind what they wanted to do with this music. They sang just their hearts out, but they also put sets together and just did everything they could to paint signs and advertise and tell their friends, and it was just an incredible time. Well, Tell Like It Is was a pretty phenomenal success in our area, and so my husband Jim wrote to Kurt Kaiser and Ralph Carmichael, and he talked to them a little bit about this youth musical that happened in Princeton. I'd like to read you a little bit of this letter. Mr. Carmichael and Mr. Kaiser, Princeton, West Virginia is not a large town. Its First Baptist Church is not a large church, but this spring, the youth of First Baptist Church gave the people of Princeton something they, nor we, shall ever forget, and you had a big part in it, so I know you'd like to know. We got to Tell It Like It Is fever just before Christmas last year. Our youth choir of about 25 zoomed to 50 before February 1st. By April 1st, our ideas had outgrown the church building, so we moved to the high school auditorium and three rehearsals a week. The adults of our youth committee developed a full portable lighting system, designed and made costumes, designed and built backdrops, developed and promoted a 16 performance schedule for the month of May. Somewhere between the middle of April and the 1st of May, Tell It ceased to be just a musical. The singers no longer looked like uncoordinated teenagers. The band was suddenly tuneful, in rhythm, and great. Solo talent, shaky and unsure in January, had blossomed and been in abundant measure. All of these fruits of arduous rehearsals were gratifying. But what set Tell It apart was the growing sense of mission that each one of us had. We sought and obtained permission from the Board of Education to present Tell It at Princeton High School and Princeton Junior High during school hours. Despite being captive, these packed auditoriums were wildly enthusiastic. And if we had had any doubts before of having a winner, these two performances removed them. On the evening following our matinee at the high school, we made history by having to turn people away from that same auditorium. We performed at Concord College, Bluefield College, and in the high schools and junior high schools of surrounding communities. Adults and performers alike willingly rearranged their whole lives. Thank you, Phyllis, and others, so many others. They did that to be faithful to our mission. The payoff for me, and I expect for you, came on a Sunday morning, May 24th. The young people had made sure that every one of the group was present for the morning service. A senior girl attended the invitation for, extended the invitation for accepting Christ or for recommitment to the congregation in general. There was no immediate response. A quartet hummed "Pass It On" while she continued the invitation, and she spoke now directly to the group, asking for those to come forward who had felt a deeper commitment to Christ and who wanted to rededicate their lives to His service. The Holy Spirit descended at that moment as surely as at Pentecost. While in the hush of a moment to be remembered forever, 50 young people came forward one by one to answer the invitation. Ours is not a demonstrative congregation. Revivals for many years have brought little outward response, but this was a revival in the truest sense of the word and a most moving experience. Getting harder to see. Okay. I would be remiss not to share it with you. Your words on the inside cover, the hours of work contained in these pages will only be significant if we hit our intended mark to plain talk kids into a confrontational experience with the truth about God's love and a relationship with His Son. You were on target, dead center. That, in a sketchy way, is what you've meant to us in these sleepy hills this spring. And we wanted you to know how grateful we were to both of you for the many hours you invested. We've never had more fun. We've never felt a deeper love for each other and for our Savior. And we have never been more ready to tackle our next assignment. We are, however, deeply aware of the tremendous responsibility placed upon us by Tillett's phenomenal success. In this, I earnestly seek your counsel. We can bring together probably 65 teenagers, more than that. Most of them now seasoned and eager for work on a worthy sequel. What shall it be? Sincerely, J.B. Copenhagen. And Ralph and Kurt wrote back, "Dear Mr. Copenhagen, in answer to your letter, we are sending you a complimentary copy of our newest musical, Natural High." And then they ask us to come to Waco, Texas for the premiere performance of Waco at Baylor University, and to for Jim to read his letter from the stage. And as soon as he finished reading and asked that question, "What's next?" they started to do Natural High. Well, of course, we were hooked on that one, and so we brought that back, and kids like that too. It's a lot. But I wanted you to know about it because there were just, it was something that God did. God did that. In 1975, we had the opportunity because of Buddy Fry, and I know Buddy was working at CBN at the time. And I probably was instrumental in getting us an invitation to come. But we did an hour-long special on CBN called It's Getting Late. And we didn't have time to show you any of the excerpts from that in the service tonight. But we would like to let you know if anybody wants to stay. Some people are going to stay afterward and go watch that DVD. I've got DVDs of that. And it's just a neat thing. And of course, they love seeing what they looked like that time then. And also their kids like to see it too, and they laugh. And I'll never forget when I went to Indy, Kansas, where my daughter lives, and all three of her girls were saying, "Oh, that was so funny, it was unbelievable." But they loved it, they really did, and these kids did too. Anyway, okay, let's see. Alright, Jim and I left Princeton in 1981 to work in California with Jim Spillman and Willie Murphy. They were two evangelists who we had done a lot of special times with, and they had had us come and sing at a huge gathering down at Montreat, which is a little place in North Carolina where I taught for a lot of years. But anyway, we had fun with them, and then they asked us to go to the British Isles with them. And that was another incredible time. And I know I'm talking a lot, but I would like for you to know a little bit about the sounds rather than just listen to them and say, "Well, that was good," or "They were off in that spot." Okay. In California, let's see. Jimmy, you were going to read that letter, weren't you? My son, Jim, is going to read another letter that Jim wrote, my husband wrote, after that trip.
Evening. Okay, this is a letter that Dad, I'm Jim Jr., by the way, wrote to Willie, who produced a newsletter a lot. And this was after we had gotten back from the British Isles. And so I just want to read this to you. Just really a letter of gratitude towards you all as a church body that helps support and send this big, gigantic group of kids who couldn't afford to go. One thing that I learned that I didn't know was that Dad had told all the kids, "Listen, all you have to do is come up with $15. You can mow yards, you can sell brownies, you can do whatever you need to do, wash cars, come up with $15 to buy your passport. The rest will be taken care of, and God provided." For years, we have read of God's miraculous provision for the ministries of His people, but how bone-deep exciting it is to experience firsthand the marvelous ways He provides funds, maneuvers, circumstances, cancels flights, and cares for His own. And yes, He used you. Your gifts made the trip possible, and your prayers made it a success. It was no accident that no one of our people experienced a single day of sickness. Not one was injured. Prayer gave us magnificent weather in a normally rainy climate. Prayer gave us perfect peace in strife-torn Belfast, and every altar call resulted in ministry to scores of people. The harvest from a season of your prayers. As an added touch, God even dimensioned our big flag a year in advance to exactly fit the castle towers. This flag was about 20 feet long, no exaggeration, and it was a huge flag. It's a beautiful flag. He taught us a great truth. The bond of Christian love is universal. In England, Ireland, Scotland, in every city we met and worked with folks we felt we had known for years, some Catholic, some Protestant, all filled with God's Spirit. Christ's love knows no nationality or creed. And a final word to all who had a part in sending the sounds on this mission journey: rejoice. From the unforgettable outpouring of God's love in the Dundonald's Girls' School in Belfast to the beautiful baptismal service in Scotland's Loch Lomond. Mission accomplished. The hardships were real, the schedule was exhausting, but there was no complaint. Growth was the rule, not the exception. Joy prevailed. There were no behavior problems. Love came home deeper than it went, and the people were blessed. Please know that your mission, prayers, and dollars produce the bountiful harvest. How beautiful it is to be a part of God's plan. So, thank you.
We are going to teach you a little song now, and I know you'd probably like to stand up for just a minute, so that's just fine. And we're going to, this song is called Little by Little. I want you to know I learned it from a ranch hand when we went to California. He was a young man who worked out in the barn, and he loved music, and he loved gospel music, and he loved God. And he shared this song with us, and I'd like to share it with you.
My little in every day, little by little in every way, Jesus is changing me.
He's changed, get ready to dance.
Since I made a turnabout face, I've been growing in his grace.
Conviction planted a little seed in my heart, and it has grown. And you know, I'm just so thankful. I won't go any farther, but I'm just truly, truly thankful.
This is a song of our time.
When there's nobody to turn to, who do I talk to? When there's nobody there to listen, who do I lean on? When there's no foundation stable,
I go to the rock. I know he's able, I go to the rock. I go to the rock. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. The mountain and the mountain stands by me.
When the earth all around me is sinking sand,
on Christ the solid rock I stand.
life all raging, who do I turn to? When those winds of sorrow blow, and this never refuge, in a time of tribulation, I go to the rock.
He's able, I go to the rock.
I go. Sinking sand, Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. The Lord is the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. Mountain and the mountain stand by me. When the earth all around me sinking sand, Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock.
I go to the rock.
I go to the rock. When I need a friend,
I go to the rock.
I can go to the rock.
I go to the rock.
When I need shelter,
I go to the rock.
You can go to the rock.
To come and introduce this song, and the reason is because she I remember when we heard about this thing that's going to happen here at First Baptist Church, she said, well, what's my solo going to be? And I don't know that she's ever sung a solo with us at all, but but I did want her to introduce this song because it made a great big difference in her life. And I want you to know she's made a great big difference in my life. She is probably the most tenacious prayer warrior I've ever met. And she prays for me all the time. I just, you know, sometimes I'll have a bad day and I won't hear from her for 2 months. And then all of a sudden she calls and she says, you know, I've been praying for you today. I've been praying for you last night, and the Lord showed me this scripture and that scripture. Well, anyway, she did that the other day, so I felt like I had to let her introduce the song.
First, I want to say that when I knew we were going to do this, when I knew we were going to do this, I asked the Lord one thing. I said, I'd like an opportunity to thank the people of this church. I mean, you all, where except the kingdom of God can you be just as close 40 years later as you were at the beginning? I mean, that's the kingdom of God. And you folks, this church, held my feet. I was a little whippersnapper at Concord, by the way. And, you know, you guys, this church stabilized me and held my feet to the fire and to the ground until God could kind of mature me a little bit. But this moment of truth, it was 1971, I think, in spring, and some roommates had said that this concert was going to be held in the ballroom at Concord. Sounds of conviction. I hadn't heard. So we went, and I fell in love with Sounds of Conviction. The Lord just, I was just, I don't know. But when they got to sing this song, Moment of Truth, there was two or three in the front row that really were keying in on whoever would look at them in the audience. And I was looking at them. I couldn't stop looking. And when they sang Moment of Truth, I'm sorry, I knew in my heart God was saying, this is your moment of truth. You gonna walk with me or not? Are we gonna keep going or are you gonna turn around? And after that, I became a Sounds groupie until they let me in out of pity because I can't sing. But they felt sorry for this groupie that kept showing up every time they sang. But the Lord has been so faithful, and you folks had a big hand in that. And I'll just throw this in to show you what a mighty God we serve. 12 months ago, I had major surgery, cancer, breast surgery, mastectomy. 11 months later, I had surgery in my colon, took out a big cancerous mass, did all this stuff with the lymph nodes and all, and went back to the doctor, in fact, last week, and he said, the lymph nodes, there was 20 that he had to take out. He said, none of it showed any cancer. That doctor said, this is unheard of. I said, not from the God I serve.
I know the one. Counting the number of people who were in the church when I was in high school, there were 20. That's it. Out of 240 people in the church, there were 20 people in the congregation that Sunday that were there when I was in high school. Most of you did not attend the Sounds concert. The Sounds concerts everywhere, including the times that we were in the school system, always had a testimony time. Always for an opportunity for those in the choir to stand up and just tell a little bit about their testimony. I'm blessed in an ageless profession where testimony is a deep, it's necessary. And testimony is where a witness gets up and under oath usually will tell about a personal experience, what they have seen, what they have heard, and what they've experienced. That's what we're going to do this evening. Is you're going to spend a little bit of time with us as we share with you a little bit about our lives. And I'm a lawyer and I have a microphone and I get to go first. That's my big sister. And I've got the microphone and she doesn't. She might have driven a long way, but that's all right. She stayed at my house and she'll behave. I was part of the Sounds from the beginning. I was part of the Sounds in the musical purpose when we were still trying to figure out exactly what we wanted to do, and I was one of the young, fresh-faced, I don't recognize those pictures, in fact, that are playing in the welcome area. And it was just something that we did in that time. Remember when this is 1970. The United States of America is in absolute turmoil over Vietnam and is looking for something, and in a small town with an engineer, think about this for a minute, with an engineer for a minister of music, there was an opportunity for a few children, a few teenagers to get on a stage and to stand up and to sing about Jesus. And that's what we started doing. And as we went forward, as we went from year to year, we went from purpose to tell it like it is, and you heard Mrs. Copenhaver Phillips, she'll always be Miss Carmen. You heard her talk about and read the letter that Mr. Copenhaver wrote to the public, to the composers of this music, saying, gentlemen, what'll it be? And what it was the next year were 160 children from all over Mercer County singing Natural High. It was a great time for this guy. I was involved there with my parents were there. My sisters were at this point in time already off at university somewhere. My parents were involved. My friends were involved. Their parents were involved. Two of my best friends in high school are not here tonight, Mark Hicks and Dave Giff. And we were at church singing, or we were at David's house shooting pool and listening to Chicago, or we were just somewhere. I mean, this is this group, folks, that we had. And this went on, and it touched our lives. And so what did it mean for me? Well, in 1973, after going to down to the first time I'd been to Virginia Beach, and we take this tape. Yes, in those days it was tape, folks. We take this television special, for it's getting late. Come back, I turn around and go to West Virginia University. And I come back in the winter in here and in the spring and followed him around a little bit in the summer of 1974 while I was working with my dad and his insurance agency and giving a good look at the practice of law. And then in January 1975, the Winfrey family changed forever. I was coming back here to practice law with Dad, and he was going to retire, and Mom and he were going to sell our house and buy a farm, and a little farm, and he was going to have a garden and a 3-head of cattle, because that was what his dream was. And that all changed for us. And then as we went forward in 1976, we lost our father in 1975. In 1976, friends quit talking to friends and started talking about them. And we had a problem here. And the sounds of conviction in a lot of people decided that it was just better if we worshiped somewhere else. And so we began a journey out in the desert. And we spent a while, and I finished and went on through law school. And sometimes you're rewarded, friends, for doing what you're supposed to do and being where you're supposed to be. Because one late October, early November Sunday morning, as I'm sitting in church in Morgantown at Calvary Baptist Church doing exactly what I'm supposed to do, I look up and there was a brown-eyed, brown-haired girl in the choir I'd never seen before. And by that evening, some of you will hear, a couple of you will remember the Vanscoys that were here, Bill and Betty Vanscoy. And they went to Morgantown when I did in the fall of 73. He was at the Soil Conservation Service. And I asked Miss Vanscoy after church that Sunday morning if she knew, if she had seen that new girl in the choir, and she said, I did. I said, you know where she are? She said, no, let me see what I can do. I went back to church that evening. She knew her name, what she was studying, and where she was from. And Stephanie Ramsey and I began to talk, and it took me a while to figure out, and here we are. Came back to Princeton in 1980. We were married in 1982. At that time, we were attending at the Presbyterian Church, but I was predestined to be a Southern Baptist. So in January, in late January 1984, I'd been telling her about this church and obviously my history. We had driven by a couple of times and that sort of thing. And I said, you know, I said, I'd like to take you to church there sometime. And she said, okay. And one Sunday morning we walked in about 2 minutes to 11. I did this just the way I wanted to. And we came in and sat down. Somebody already had the back row, but we got the next to the back row there where Mary Bailey usually sits. And at the welcome time, I didn't know what to do. Because apparently all of you that were there at the time saw us come in and just made us immediately incredibly welcome. About 2-3 weeks later as we were attending, and I discussed this with Mom, and she said, we are a family and I'll be back too. Candy Stanley introduced me to this fellow named Stuart Sigmund and his wife Dawn. And we met them, and Stuart seemed pretty straight, and Dawn just seemed just kind of, you know, kind of flat personality. And they said, we'd like you all to join the choir. And then the next week I got a rehearsal and find out that we're in the middle of a musical with costumes and acting for Easter called Breakfast in Galilee. And we were back. We've raised 2 sons here. You met David in 1990. Dave Docker came with his family. And he's my age, and we just hit it off immediately. He became special to us in September that year when we had a funeral for a daughter. And then a couple of years later, Craig Stout came along, and Craig Stout is responsible for my son William, who I love with all my heart, being alive during age 14 and me not going to jail. That, friends, is what a youth minister does for his youth and for the family. I've told him that before, and it's the truth. My family has been blessed worshiping. I have been fortunate to be able to come home. I've been fortunate to be able to serve God in this place. This group behind me is part of the fabric of my life. What have I learned? What have I learned? Learned a couple of things. One of the things is in the spring of 73, I was also blessed with being the youth pastor here and preached the sermon on Youth Sunday Morning, and the passage was singular. Any man putting his hand to the plow and looking backwards has no use in the kingdom of God. We've had a wonderful time here. looking back. But God's spoken to me in many different ways, and for those of you that follow me on Facebook, and you saw this morning, I had a very happy day. Stephanie and Beth were out doing some things. I was in the house, and I just, for some reason, got the urge and just flipped on an album by the group Chicago and started playing. God speaks to me in a lot of ways, and one of the ways He speaks to me is sometimes in just secular music. And we were listening to a little tune by Chicago at the end of this, and the question is, where do we go from here? No looking back, but with the foundation that I got from these young people behind you, from these folks sitting over here, we go forward in the kingdom of God's service.
Being a member of the Sounds of Conviction for about 4 years, I think, until Reverend Carter's daughter, that was and remains one of my dearest friends, Jane, shanghaied me to a musical called Here Comes the Sun on December 5th, 1975. And I was seated in the sanctuary. It was a Christmas musical. And for those of you that attend First Baptist, if you kind of picture where Mary Beth normally sits, approximately, I think the Air Force or the Navy came in and put an ejector seat underneath me, because at the end of that service, Carson Hicks was standing down at the communion table, much like our own pastor does every Sunday morning, and he just presented the plan of salvation after I'd heard this wonderful music. And I really honestly don't think I had a choice, because somebody pulled the ejector and I was propelled down that aisle. And I leapt and I up and ran to Carson Hicks, and with open arms he received me. And it was a struggle as a kid, you know, you just get into all kinds of funny things, and but this group gave me the foundation to start to grow as a Christian. And even though I left and went off in the Navy and did a tremendous amount of things that were not Christ-like, when I returned to West Virginia, I returned back to my walk with the Lord, and I returned back to First Baptist Church. And like they do with everyone, they opened their arms and received me back. Mr. Hicks was responsible for laying every sound cable, every microphone. And many years ago, a gentleman was running our sound, and late one night I got a phone call on Friday and said, "You have to do sound on Sunday." I went, "Oh, really? Mute, unmute, more volume, less volume. What do I know?" And somewhere in the deep recesses of my mind, I remembered a lot of the things that Mr. Hicks had taught me. And for those of you that know, I'm the best Baptist here, because I have the back row. Nobody sits behind me. But I do take care of their technology for it, and I've tried, but I'm kind of self-taught. But God has honored my intent and blessed me. I'm not sure that He's blessed anybody else, but He's blessed me through that ministry. And I have this group of my brothers and sisters to thank for presenting the gospel to me. I have Mr. Hicks for being the one to receive me at the end of the aisle, but I have this church to thank for receiving me back home. So I just want to say, nothing, absolutely nothing, can keep you from the love of God. Amen. except your unwillingness to receive it. Thank you.
Baptist Church. When I grew up, my first year of school was segregation. The next year, it was integration. We have our church. We went to our church. You didn't come to yours. You didn't come to ours. Got us down to First Baptist Church. And you never felt that. It was a little hard being that young, trying to understand what is the problem. We all could get together and sing and feel welcome and have fun. and wear real nice outfits, by the way. I just didn't understand, but I do want to thank you, and I really want to thank Ms. Martin, because if it wasn't for her, I would not have known about this anniversary or reunion. Thank you.
Don't make me say anything, please don't make me say anything. But just when Bill was talking, I'm Terry Copenhaver, by the way, as I was getting ready to come to this, kind of reminiscing about the sounds, the metaphor that sort of came to mind was that when we're born, time is this relentless river that moves with a forward-moving current. And it doesn't go backwards, it only goes forwards. So I was looking back through my memorabilia and thinking, wow, that was a point in time that, you know, my life started, God put me in this little boat of time moving forward. But every once in a while, God lets you get out of the boat and gather on the bank with an extraordinary group of people and experience something that's just unbelievable. That as you look back at it, you're like, that was, I mean, sleepy little Princeton with the choir going all over the world. It was just unbelievable. And so that was fun thinking about that. And I thought, okay, well, God, okay, yes, it was extraordinary. But now what? I get back in the boat and we all move on with our lives and we all go all different places all over the world. So what, God, is the takeaway from this weekend? We shouldn't just look back. He let us be in a time where he showed us with him, the ordinary is not ordinary. We don't have to settle for ordinary. My dad, I realize now that my dad models that for me. Why settle for ordinary when you can have extraordinary? So as we move forward in time, that's what God wants us to take away. Don't settle for ordinary, because he's never ordinary.
I ran around with in school who were on the set crew. And hanging out with them, I ended up on the set crew. Mom and Dad, I think, kind of checked out Sounds of Conviction to see what it was about. And of course, you all who know the Walkers, you know that my dad was the Pentecostal holiness preacher. So we just couldn't go anywhere with anybody. But I thank God for Sounds of Conviction. Today was like coming home. Today, we touched on it as we shared during our practice time. Election, which Faith's husband brought to us. Then Renee brought to us about seeds planted. And as I sit there and listen, thought of a seed, and the seed that was planted, there were many seeds planted in our lives, but relationship. We all have a very strong relationship because some of us don't look like we did back that many years ago. But our hearts and our spirits reconnected, and we knew each other. And it was like we started at the next season of a Sounds performance. We were just on summer vacation. Lord, what happened to you, Tim? But I thank God for First Baptist Church. I thank God for people like Phyllis Martin, Ms. Lyda Winfrey, Mr. Carson Hicks, and Leonard Crawford, Bill Myers, Harry and Barbara Fields. You know, some are going on and some are still here with us. And I'm glad the ones that are here with us, my mom, there was Billy and Ivan Taylor. I thank God that the ones that are still here with us, that we can say to them, thank you for allowing us. Thank you for loving us. And greatest of all, Mr. and Mrs. C, you had a huge family. And you had a whole lot of kids. And I think the only person that you would have been in competition with would have been God. Because you all had to be very godly people to put up with all of us. And thank you all for the seeds that you planted. Thank you for setting us on a path that has made us successful, that has, some of us have failed miserably, but you set us on a path that through our failures we didn't stay. We were able to get up and continue on with this journey. Thank you.
We have been.